Honors. My name is Chris Sargent, and I'm here representing Paravue Corporation. I'd like to reserve at least 5 minutes for rebuttal, please.
Okay.
This is a case that's on appeal from a summary judgment ruling by a bankruptcy court and affirmed by the U.S. District Court, finding that a statute of limitations on legal malpractice had lapsed prior to the signing of a tolling agreement that occurred less than 1 year after the appellee here had actually stopped providing legal services in the form of corporate and transactional advice. Heller's provision of substantive legal services after the critical date here, which was July 11th, 2007, both in the litigation with acuity and in the corporate governance, preclude the grant of summary judgment in this dispute.
Why don't you just zero in? So post July 11th, 2007, what's the most significant provision of legal advice you say your client got from the Heller Ehrman folks?
Well, there's the two different ways that Heller Ehrman was representing Paravue. There was the litigation with acuity, and then there was the general corporate representation that went back to the very inception of the corporation. In the litigation alone, on July 13th, Heller Ehrman appeared in court in the Santa Clara Superior Court representing Paravue.
Wait, was that the withdrawal to argue that please let us out of this mess?
No, that was actually on a motion for preliminary injunction, I believe.
I thought they had already moved to withdraw by that point.
They had given notice of an ex parte request to withdraw, but that hearing had been continued from July 12th to July 17th. So they appeared at that hearing. After that hearing, Heller Ehrman prepared the proposed order on a temporary restraining order, not a preliminary injunction, and negotiated that and got an acquired approval of that proposed order from the incoming counsel for Paravue, who had not yet substituted Mr. Ackerman, as well as the counsel for acuity, Mr. McLeod. And then they wrote a letter and submitted that letter to Judge McKinney on July 19th, which was after the substitution of counsel.
So do we look at the negotiation time, I guess the negotiation of terminating, or the course consideration of termination, or do we look at the time of the intent to terminate?
The test under the CCP, or California Code of Civil Procedure 340.6, is how long did representation continue for, actual representation for. So the intention...
So getting at does actual representation continue when the representing attorneys say, I'm out?
The representation absolutely can continue after that. There's multiple decisions of the California Court of Appeal that have found so. We rely pretty heavily on the Gerkowitz decision, where after they had provided notice of withdrawal, they then worked on a memorandum of costs on appeal. They negotiated that with opposing counsel, and then that was submitted, and then there was a second notice of determination of the representation that took place. And the Court of Appeal found that the fact that there was an earlier notice of termination didn't matter when there was subsequent legal services that had actually been provided.
What do you say about the earlier determinations? Do you think those were actual notices that to be given validity?
In the Gerkowitz case, the lawyer sent a letter saying our representation has ended.
I mean, in this case, when there was a statement, I believe, by Mr. Hulk, I think it was saying that we intend to withdraw next week.
Well, one of the interesting things about Mr. Hogg's email, he doesn't actually say that Heller will not provide legal services anymore. What he provides is notice of an ex parte application of his intent to seek a withdrawal from representation in the litigation.
So, counsel, Judge Gould, if I could interject just to clarify. In my mind, is it your position that the representation continues until the court signs an order that states that the representation's over?
The California courts have been clear that there's no bright line test, Your Honor. So the court signing the order of withdrawal is in of itself not necessarily the end of the representation.
So does that mean we couldn't give your client a partial summary judgment in effect and a ruling if we agreed with you? We'd have to remand it because of a fact issue to the trial court.
I believe that's correct, Your Honor, yes. there's an issue about exactly which, and it's the California courts talk about this being an issue of fact that is normally not decided on summary judgment unless it's very clear they have a strong set of undisputed facts. Here, I believe there are actually undisputed facts of acts of representation by Paravue after the critical date. The appearance at the hearing I just mentioned in the litigation, the preparation and negotiation of the order are all classical kinds of activities that the California courts have found sufficient to find a continuing representation. There's also representations that continue to occur on the corporate and transactional side of this relationship after the critical date of July 11th.
It appears, though, that does it not that the bankruptcy court insisted said that there were a series of emails, I think around the 3rd to the 7th of July, that the judge concluded that so we're looking at these emails. Clearly, this relationship had ended.
Well,
there was no dispute.
First, the fact that they continue to actually provide legal services means that whatever the parties themselves may have believed at the time doesn't matter. What matters is whether or not substantive legal services continue to be provided after the critical date. The other problem with the lower court's ruling is that the documents that Judge Montali was looking at with respect to that time period between July 3rd and 7th and even up to July 10th were with respect to Dr. Barku in her individual capacity. And I would submit that he was improperly conflating Dr. Barku, who was at that time a member of the board, the CSO, and actively litigating individually against security with Paravue, the corporation. And the perspective for the purposes of when the relationship ends is that of Paravue. But I don't think the court needs to even get there in this particular case because of the substantial litigation activities that took place after the critical date.
And what about on the corporate side post-July 11th?
So on the corporate side, you have the email from Mr. Dow where he's working on the cap table, and this had actually been raised as an issue by Dr. Bargood in an email prior to that time where she said in a discussion with Heller Ehrman's litigation counsel, hey, the capitalization table is a problem in this case, and this is in the record here. And then Mr. Dow emails Mr. McLeod, who's the attorney actually for Acuity, so it's a little, the context is a little odd, but it does show that he was providing corporate services on what was a pretty important issue. And one of the core disputes in the Acuity litigation was corporate control. And capitalization, who owns and what portion of the shares, is a huge issue for how this gets resolved.
I'm not sure it matters because I know you're relying on heavily on the litigation side, but does that aspect of the corporate representation, is it, I can't remember the language of 340.6, but it has to be specifically related. You know,
the same
specific, whatever, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, the same subject.
Yeah. Is that meant with respect to that? Because it sounds different from the whole loan fiasco that occurred.
That's correct. There is some distance between the specifics of the cap table and the overall disputes that were going on between Paravue and Acuity regarding the notes and the failures that Heller Ehrman had with respect to the creation of those documents, as well as the activities that took place within the litigation. However, had Heller Ehrman provided an accurate cap table at the beginning of all of those issues, it would have simplified them. And there were a lot of motions in the Acuity litigation around whether or not Dr. Barguet could exercise her rights as a shareholder, for example. And there was disputes about what percentage of shares that she had. So if there was an accurate cap table, I think that would have had an interaction with those issues in the litigation.
Yeah, it seems like a stretch. Is there anything else on the corporate side?
There's also the preparation, the advice that was given with respect to the transition when Mr. Hudnick left on July 9th and 10th, and the process of Dr. Barguet becoming CEO as of July 13th. There was a corporate resolution prepared that lines up with the typical stylings of the Heller-Ehrman resolution that had been prepared previously. And Dr. Barguet said in a declaration that Heller-Ehrman had agreed that they would help to make sure a shareholder meeting would take place after July 10th.
Well, what about an appeal? Was there an appeal?
Yes, there
What was that about? What about representation in that relief?
The appeal was from one of the preliminary injunction orders, and I'm not certain which of them it was. There were actually two in the Santa Clara Superior Court litigation. And there's an email on the record where, after July 19th even, where Kent Heller Ehrman is discussing the process of withdrawing from the court of their status as counsel of record and whether or not to seek a substitution for Mr. X. That didn't occur until July 24th, that substitution.
Can I ask you if you're kind of pause, I hate to interrupt your train of thought, but there is an email whose the data of which I can't remember, in which it was after I think Heller said we want to get out, and maybe even after it had filed the motion to withdraw. But doesn't Paravue, I can't remember who sent this, sorry. But they basically say, look, we need an accounting of every dollar we've ever paid you in legal fees. And as a matter of fact, we want to know how much you're going to give us back. And that communication did seem to me the best on your opponent's side for saying, even Paravue didn't think that this relationship was ongoing. I mean, that was just kind of the end of the road, right?
Oh, well, the email that you're referring to, I believe, was actually sent by Dr. Bargate's personal counsel, and I think that there's another potential issue of conflation there, that the lower courts inferred into that email that Dr. Bargate's personal counsel was acting for Paravue, but there's no evidence in the record outside of that one email that he ever had any representation relationship with Paravue. In fact, all of the other documents in the record show that he was counsel for Dr. Bargate personally, alone, representing her interests as the majority shareholder in Paravue. And that email did not, there's a phrase.
It was about a dispute also, wasn't it? It went back to a dispute between the, one of the companies, the CEO, I guess, at the time. Who said that she had withdrawn or resigned, and she said she was venting. Is that right? So he decides that, well, yeah, you resigned, I accept your resignation. Then she says, no, I didn't resign. And she's really hiring a personal counsel to contest her status with the company.
Yeah, that's right, Your Honor. At the beginning of all of the litigation, or right before all the litigation started, there was a dispute about whether or not Dr. Bergen had resigned as CSO. Not, she was not CEO.
That's what I'm trying to get. So where did he transition to be a quasi-representative for the Paravue?
No, Your Honor. He was representing Dr. Bergen's interest as a shareholder in Paravue. So to the extent that her interests as a shareholder were aligned with the corporation, yes, there would have been arguments made that would have been a benefit to Paravue, the corporation, but he was never counsel for Paravue, the entity. And it's just demonstrated by the history of the substitutions here. There's no temporary period where Dr. Bargate's counsel was representing Paravue and went straight from Heller Ehrman to Mr. Ackerman.
Counsel, Judge Gould, if I could interject, would you like to save a little time for rebuttal? Because at least as one judge here, I would appreciate hearing your perspectives in a short form after your opponent has stated their sort of sailing your position.
I would like that very much, Your Honor.
Okay, very good. Why don't you sit down, we'll hear from your opponents and have you back up.
Thank you, Your Honors. May it please the Court, my name is Marjorie Manning, and I represent the appellee, Heller Ehrman, in this matter. First of all, to address Judge Gould's question, I do not believe that there is a single disputed material fact in this case. What there is a very heated dispute over the legal effect of the undisputed facts. And
you're saying that there are no disputed facts about whether the emails as found by the bankruptcy judge that they've been in to the representation. And the reason I ask you this is because one of the emails else was what Mr. Holger said. You should understand that if a curator does not make, does not in the near term dismiss Paravue from the pending Santa Clara court, county action, I expect that Ella Ehrman will seek to withdraw his counsel
next week
in that action, possibly as early as next week. And then it goes on to show if she believes that she has the legal basis that she should request another counsel. So what I'm saying is, words like if, near term, expect, will seek, and possibly, how those determinative words, when it comes to saying there's a definite end to a relationship as far as counsel on the court.
I believe those are two different emails.
If this is one of them, how do we...
There is an email that says you should know that if Acuity does not dismiss Heller from this litigation, we may well move to withdraw as early as next week. There is a subsequent email. In fact, there are two subsequent emails giving at least two, if not three, giving notice of withdrawal, intent to withdraw, and there are at least two emails postdating the one you're talking about.
Who were those sent to?
They were sent to Lauren Barghout and Mr. Russo.
Personal attorney. And she was not CEO at the time, is that right?
He was initially her personal attorney, but then he took on the mantle of demanding that certain actions be taken on behalf of Paravue. And by July 9, 2011, he had, the same day Hudnick resigned, the same day, or the day before, for Lauren Barghout appointed herself CEO, he actually filed on behalf of Paravue application for TRO and preliminary injunction to stay the Acuity scheduled foreclosure sale. So Mr. Russo became more and more and more and more involved as time went on.
I understand what you're saying, but doesn't that create questions of fact as to what is the precise relationship? What is his role? What is his authority? Who is acting on behalf of the corporation? That's what my question is. I'm not arguing that there's some indication that there's a termination or a desire to terminate, but is it important who it goes to, what it says, and in other words, how is it an undisputed fact is what I'm getting at. Isn't that really a question of fact is what all this means?
There really is no question of fact as to what the emails say, whether they were sent, whether they were delivered, who they were copied to. There is none. And the only question is, what is the effect of that under prevailing California law, which is application of undisputed facts to legal principles, which is the very essence of summary judgment, of course. So what I'm saying is we might withdraw as early next week. We are withdrawing. I'm telling Keller what to do as Ms. Barghout's so-called personal counsel became, I demand that you take these actions on behalf of Paravue. And when Heller refused, again and again, in writing, Mr. Russo filed the document himself. So you can't very well say, gee, I really wasn't representing Paravue. What all Heller was.
But Mr. Russo doesn't decide of his own unilaterally that he's representing Paravue, does he?
The point is, just to say as an introduction to this, all of those events that I'm talking about, every single one of them happened no later than they were over by July 10, So they are, they render the claim time barred in and of themselves. No, he couldn't just appoint himself counsel, Mr. Russo. You are correct. But the point is not who technically represents the client under California law. The point is, for purposes of tolling, as opposed to for purposes of the existence of an attorney-client relationship, to look at whether or not a reasonable person or entity, if you will, in the client's position would expect that further services will be provided. And
because if that is true, then there's a toll.
Pardon me?
Because if it is true that a person could reasonably expect continued representation, then that would toll the running of the statute. Is that right?
Not that person, but a reasonable person in that person's position. In other words, it's a reasonableness standard, correct?
But I'm saying if it were reasonable, as you suggest, to whomever was required to be, then that would toll the statute.
But under California law, case authority equates, and there's nothing to contradict this, equates being told, we will not represent you, with actual knowledge that the representation has ended. And overarching this reasonableness standard is the purpose of the continuous representation tolling provision once the client discovers negligence or malpractice, once that's not the issue. The purpose is to prevent the disadvantaged client from being duped by the attorney so that the attorney can run out the statute. The cases, every case that addresses this purpose recognizes when tolling, when the purpose for the rule ends, tolling ends. And here what we have, less than 1 year, certainly before the critical date, we have Paravue accusing Heller of malpractice. We have Heller saying, I am out of here. You let me know if you consent. We have Paravue saying, well, sure, for price. You bet. Give us back everything we've paid you over the last 6 years or so and get back all the stock we took even longer than ago than that we bought. Sure. As Judge Montali so aptly put it, the holding hostage email. We have that. We have Michael Ackerman on the 10th, July 10th, coming to a hearing with Lauren Barkhout, who has appointed herself CEO, effective immediately. And Mr. Ackerman advises the court, I am prepared to come in and represent Paravue if Heller withdraws. And, of course, Heller has already announced its intention to withdraw. Now, under Hensley, which is one of the key critical appellate decisions here, the client became unhappy with the attorney, went to a new attorney and said, will you represent me? And that attorney said, no, I can't, not until your former attorney substitutes out. And the appellate court said, bingo, there's the date. It doesn't matter that all these formalities remained to be inked and the T's crossed and the I's dotted. That was the date you acted. You, client, acted. And it doesn't matter what your attorney thought, and it doesn't even matter that after that, attorney number one, the would-be defendant, communicated with opposing counsel.
What if they continue to do work for the corporation? situation as your opponent.
Well, with respect to that, there is not one piece of evidence in the entire record that indicates, nor is there a citation to one, I might add, that indicates that Heller, specifically Attorney Thau, or even anyone else for that matter, gave Ms. Barkhout advice on how to make herself the CEO. That's just made up from whole cloth. There's none.
What about the July 13th hearing? You're going to place a lot of weight on that. What do you have to say to that?
The July 13th hearing, much like the hearings that preceded it, was a hearing at which Heller showed up. But the arguments that were advanced by Mr. Ehrman. Mr. Ehrman submitted a declaration. We have cited it in our brief indicating he was appearing for Paravue at that hearing, number one.
Counsel, Judge Gould, if I could ask you a question.
Yes.
What the relationship between what a reasonable client would think about the representation and the particular conduct that your friend on the other side cited to us that Heller did in court?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
What does the action, what's the relationship, if any, between the conduct of what Heller did in court and what a reasonable client would think about whether the representation continued?
The hallmark of continuous representation is an ongoing mutual relationship and activities in furtherance thereof. Heller went to that hearing. Heller, who had an obligation to assist with the transition, went to that hearing and Michael Ehrman appeared for Paravue. It's undisputed. It's in his declaration under penalty of perjury. So Heller shows up to assist with the transition. The reasonable client, who by now is Ms. Barkhout, who has been accusing Heller of conspiring with Acuity to throw the whole lawsuit into Acuity's pocket, has Mr. Russo in the wings, Mr. Ehrman next to her, and has no reason whatsoever to believe that Heller is going to provide future services, in no small part because Heller has told her so again and again, not simply because of her status, but because, as Heller puts it twice, there are no facts to justify interfering with Acuity's rights in this litigation. That's what you want. You go have to go find somebody else. And then last, we have Ms. Barkhout, not as an individual shareholder, but by Russo's express language, as the, quote, CEO and sole remaining director of Paravue, unquote, consenting withdrawal as long as Heller pays the ransom. So it's a nightmare. It's an absolute nightmare, is what a reasonable person would view this as being. I guess here's my attorney that I've accused of conspiracy to his face. I've submitted declarations to the court accusing him of conspiracy. Certainly he's malpracticed. I've demanded back all the money that's ever been paid. And you know, I've got these other attorneys following me around to court hearings and filing their own motions from Paravue. But, gee, I thought Heller would just continue on as my counsel. It's untenable. And it's not supported by a single case. And Ms. Barkhout admitted in deposition, those are precisely the terms on which I was willing to let Heller out and consent to withdraw. So no public policy that underlies any of the published California decisions is furthered by the results that Paravue seeks here. Not a single one. In fact, it would make a mockery of the relationship.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Counsel, your time. You're over your time at this point.
I know I am. I apologize. Thank you.
No, you're answering Judge Lowe's question. That's fine. So let's give you 2 minutes for rebuttal. Hear what you have to say in response.
Thank you, Your Honor. First, I would request and urge the court to stick to the language of the statute here. The language of the statute isn't about what everyone was thinking at any one given time. Those are all factors that play into whether or not representation was actually continuing. And the best evidence of whether or not a relationship was actually continuing is that services continued to be provided.
But your opponent has just said that at that July 13th hearing, in fact, no service was really rendered. Yes, Heller showed up in, form, but in fact, the other lawyer that the doctor brought in is the person who made the argument or whatever. So, what do you have to say to that?
Mr. Ehrman wasn't there on July 13th as counsel for Paravue. He didn't become counsel for Paravue until July 17th. He was there as counsel for Dr. Barkhout individually, like Mr. Russo, in anticipation of becoming counsel for Paravue. So, the record is clear that there's the portions of the record submitted by Heller Ehrman, there's a declaration from Mr. Ackerman where he talks about having been appointed as counsel, not substituted in by Judge McKinney on July 17th. He wasn't there as counsel, and these aren't simply formalities. These are important facts about determining exactly when attorney-client relationships get established between these parties. And to go back to Judge Gould's point about, what would the reasonable client under similar circumstances expect when an attorney appears at a hearing and says they're going to prepare a court order and then does prepare a court order, submits that to opposing counsel, gets their approval on it, and then submits it to the judge all after the fact, I think it would be very reasonable for a client to expect services to continue to be provided.
What do you say on so counsel's argument to the court that notwithstanding the one email that I pointed out, but that if you read all of those together, a series of them, I think she said there were two or three others that were more direct. How do you say that is a question of fact?
The question is a matter of inferences, Your Honor, and I actually think this is where if the court doesn't find that the activities that took place after the critical date were sufficient just on their own, and you're looking to what happened before the critical date, a lot of inferences have to be drawn about what those different communications mean. So, for example, the communications from Heller Ehrman we're talking about on July 6th, Mr. Hawk, I think it was the email you were referring to, wrote a long email about how he cannot take instructions from Dr. Barkhout. He can only take instructions from the CEO. And after which, when Dr. Barkhout tried to appoint herself as CEO, not effectively on July 10th, she had every reason to believe that, hey, I'm the CEO now, by his own email 4 days earlier, Mr. Hawk should now be taking my instructions, and now I can have Heller Ehrman on my side in this litigation. So I think that there are multiple inferences that can be drawn from those particular things, and it's against the rules for summary judgment to make those inferences in favor of Heller Ehrman instead of